Good to see you out. I think it's going to get hot today, don't you? Working on it, but I'm glad you're here. Thanks for using our air conditioning. Good. What an adventuresome week. Yesterday was a very special day around here. One of the deacons in our church got married. All right, Mark Downs is now a married man. He waited 52 years to get married. All right. So, yeah, pray for her. Yeah. But so Mark and Michelle are off. He's already texted me this morning. I told him, sorry, Mark, you're on your own now, buddy. I can't help you anymore from this point on. But it was fun anyway. It was a great day. Thanks. This was kind of a church. We often don't make weddings church events, you know. Though a lot of us, but Mark needed a lot of help getting ready for this. All right. And so to the Shaws, all right, who did yeoman's work in transforming the bridge into a reception center, and it looked beautiful last night. They just did a great job. Tammy Harris, she made the cake, and lots of other folks chipped in and helped in so many different ways. And so we say thank you for all the hard work. We'll be excited to see them back from their honeymoon. I just can't imagine the stories Mark will have. But anyway, do be praying for them. If you are a guest here at New Hope today, thank you for choosing New Hope as your place of worship today. There's some communication cards in the pew in front of you. I'd love for you to take one, fill it out, drop it in the offering when it comes by, and next week through the mail, not at your door, not on the phone, but through the mail, send you information that tells you what goes on around here. Milo, would you ask them to close that outside door, because the bright sunshine off of somebody's window is killing me. Thank you very much. All right, so we want to get that information in your hands. Let me highlight a few things that are going on around here and get to some prayer requests and praise items, and then we'll get engaged in our worship today. Next Sunday is Widow's Lunch Bunch, and that meets at 12:30, and the restaurant and the address are in your bulletin, so take note of that. Giggles and Goodies, you can see Fawn next week for tickets. Fresno Grizzly tickets, you can see Mark Addis for those. That's coming up August the 12th, Friday night, $16 a ticket. That's Christian music night as well, so it should be a great time for all who want to go, and we kind of sit together at that event. Mike Cousineau is going to be with us next Sunday. All right, Mike and Deline are flying in. They're going to be with us. Next Sunday service will be a little bit different than normal. All right, but I think it'll be really, really good. We're going to get to hear from Mike. You're going to get to hear from some of us who were in Africa last February. We're going to get an update on our adopted city in Ivory Coast, the adopted village called Neonan, where we have built two dormitories. House about 50 kids because they are getting an education in Neonan like they have never had before. As you know, education is so important for that area of the country. It is impoverished. It is the bush. It is inaccessible by so many resources. And because of the love of the Lord that one lady, Madame Elise, had to follow God's direction in her life, she left the big city of Abidjan. She got on a bus. She rode for 16 or 17 hours. When the bus line ended, she got out and she walked, okay, for more than 8 miles. She took a dirt road to a smaller road to a path. She was just praying, God, where do you want me to share my life? And she ended up in this little village called Neonan. And there was a schoolhouse that had been built in the late 80s or the early 90s, and no one had ever taught there. It was dilapidated. It was run down. And she went to the village chief and said, may I teach your children? He said, sure, but we're not going to pay you anything. And he said, and you got to ask the government if it's okay. So she walked her miles back to the bus, got on the bus, went back to Abidjan. She asked the government, may I teach in that school in Neonan? They said, sure, but we're not going to pay you anything. And she said, that is fine. She got back on the bus, loaded her stuff, walked her 7 or 8 miles back to the village in Neonan, and she started asking the villagers to send their kids to her for an education. When you finish the sixth grade there, you have to take a test in order to go to junior high. Only 10% of the students in the country pass the sixth grade test. Her first class to go take the test was 30 kids that she had taught now for just 2 years, and they were taking the junior high test. All 30 students passed. It was then that Mike introduced the village of Neonan to New Hope Church. And that's when we started our relationship with them. Since then, just last year, the second highest test score ever in the country of Ivory Coast on the sixth grade test came from one of her students last year. And people are taking notice in the big city of Abidjan. They actually sent out representatives this past year to the village when we dedicated the second dormitory that New Hope built there in the little village of Neonan. And they're giving encouragement like they've never given before. So we're going to find out what our next phase is with the little village of Neonan and what we can do to continue to make a difference in a part of the world that hardly anybody ever goes to. We'll also find out about the next trip in February. This will be my fifth trip. This was my commitment, all right, originally was if I'm going to go once, I'm going to go five times. So I will be keeping my commitment this next year. I'm not telling you it's my last one. But I would love to take 10 people from New Hope on that trip. I'll tell you up front, it costs $3,000. Okay? So you start saving now if you'd like to go. You're probably not too old. it's the hardest 2 weeks you'll ever spend in your life. This is not an easy trip. All right? Lindsay can tell you that. The Childresses can tell you that. Lee says she's going back again. All right? She has back trouble. She has pain. She is born in Korea. She lives in the United States, and she goes to Ivory Coast, Africa for mission work. It's the way God works. But you can be involved in construction. Shelly is going again this year. We'll be leading a kids' fest in the Onan Village. You can work in the kids' fest. You can maybe if you've got skills, you can help Steve in the technical side of things. He's bringing the modern age to the village of Doropo with some computer work for medical supplies and all kinds of supplies, in fact. You can work in a hospital. You can work in recovery. There's all kinds of ways that you can be engaged, and it will literally change your life. And so you'll hear more about that next week. So you want to be at one of the three services next Sunday. I will send out an email about this next part. I'm still talking myself in or out of my next idea. I think we're going to do a potluck dinner next Sunday night. We haven't done a potluck here in years. And I think we may do a potluck. We'll do it in the other two buildings probably. We'll see how many show up. But it'll be a chance for some more one-on-one time with Mike and his wife, Deline, at the end of the day. All right? So anyway, that's next Sunday. You don't want to miss it. You'll get to see some pictures and hear some testimonies of what went on there. So those are the things that are coming up. Let me share with you one other announcement. Oh, by the way, Jan Patton was in church last service. First time since her stabbing. All right? So she is recovered. And it was great to have her. We had a chance to have a prayer of thanksgiving with her in the last service. Last Tuesday night, we did the introduction to the You and Me Forever Bible study. It's the seven-week Bible study on marriage. It's unlike any other Bible study on marriage you have ever been engaged with. I think I said enough about it the last couple of weeks. If you missed last week, it's not too late to be a part of the class. I did an introduction last week because I felt like everybody really needed to have their books and to be able to read chapter one before we see the first video this week. It starts promptly at 7 o'clock. Child care is provided, and we're out of here at 8:10, okay? So it's an hour and 10 minutes, and we had a lot of fun last week. We had singles. We had married. We had married less than 5 months. We had married more than 65 years. So we covered a lot of gamuts. We had engaged. We had dating. We had not dating. Just about every you can imagine. And I think you're going to enjoy this study. And if you missed it, you weren't here for the sign-ups the last 2 weeks, you can come see Shelly. She has books up here underneath the pew, $10 for the books, or you can download it free on your iPad, iPhone, or smart device, okay? So that takes care of, I think, that event. Let me highlight a few prayer requests then. Gil and Angelina Hernandez, our missions pastor and his wife. As you know, they are in Mexico. Starting today, he is going to be translating for a mission activity that will be going on this week, a Bible conference in Mexico. They've been there about almost 2 weeks already. You know, she has a home there, they share. Gil has a home here that they share. Last week, their home there burned to the ground. Hey, just got that information on Friday. I got some pictures yesterday. I didn't have a chance to get them to Milo. They were at dinner at somebody else's home and got a call that there was a fire at their house. The time they got there, it was consumed in flames. A neighbor's propane tank exploded and launched into the backside of her home. And pretty much a total loss from all the information. Gil says, we're fine, we're doing well, we're going to be okay. Lost a lot of personal items, but they are so grateful that they weren't home when that transpired. And so be praying for them as they go through that situation. Angie Monroy, Angela's mom, is she's been moved again. She's not at physical therapy home anymore. She is now at the California Armenian home. She's continuing to get care and additional physical therapy as she recovers from her stroke. So please be praying for her. Charlene Dooms, Bernice Osborne's daughter, who, as you know, is up in Roseville getting cancer treatment, 3 radiation treatments a day. This will go on for 3 weeks. Friday, they started taking their toll. She's experiencing a lot of challenges and a lot of trauma right now. So please be remembering them as they go through this. Two families specifically I could remember to be praying for God's care and comfort. Yesterday morning here at the church, we did a service for Verna Thatcher. Didn't find out until the service yesterday. There were about 5 or 6 folks from New Hope that have been friends of Verna's for a long, long time. One of them actually went to high school with her at Roosevelt 60 years ago. And so be praying for her husband, Stuart. They had been married almost 55 years, and he would appreciate your prayers. And then on Friday, I did a service out at Woodward Park for Adam Smith. Adam Smith is a young man that was shot and killed by Clovis police about 12 days ago when they tried to serve a warrant on him. And he was high. He took his vehicle and charged the police with it. The fact that somebody gets killed in that situation does not negate the fact that they deserve a funeral. They deserve to be recognized. Their family deserves to be cared for and comforted. And so we did that service on Friday morning. Adam has a son who's 11 years old. His name is Adam. Absolutely one of the sweetest, most delightful young boys I've been around in a long, long time. He was so much fun. He's very well-mannered. He's very well-spoken. And his mom does a really, really good job with him. But I appreciate you remember to pray for Adam. His brother Chris, they had the same mom, different dad. Chris was about 9-10 years older than Adam, who was killed. Chris and his wife took Adam in when he was 14. His dad went to prison. His dad was a PhD from Stanford, and his dad ended up in prison for molesting probably over 30 children in the Palo Alto area back in the 1990s. So this has been a terrific life for this young man. And not an excuse, but I do want you to remember to pray for his family and God's care in their lives during these days. We also need to be praying for all of our police departments across the country. I understand there's been another shooting this morning with law enforcement killed in Louisiana. So all lives matter. All lives matter. It's not blue, it's not black, it's not white. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish but have everlasting life. And that is a message that we need to get out. I'm going to ask our ushers if they'll come forward at this time as we receive our morning tithes and offering. Let's pray. You're in for a treat today with our offertory, and Mila will tell you more about that in just a minute. Our Father, I love you. I'm grateful for your Son, the Lord Jesus, and the difference that he makes in our lives. And I pray, Father, that we would not just be thrilled and excited about the difference that Jesus makes in our life, but I trust that we could be thrilled and excited about the difference that Jesus can make in our world. And I trust that we would look for ways to allow him in and through us to make a difference in our world. Sometimes it means speaking out. Sometimes it means showing up. Sometimes it means making decisions that really will bring about some form of suffering. It's hard for us to imagine that. We try to avoid those decisions that bring suffering. And yet, Father, I'm convinced there are going to be occasions that we will make decisions that from purely a comfort standpoint are not in our best interest, are not in our country's best interest, not in our world's best interest. Father, just for example, a decision to make make a decision to go to Africa. That's not for our comfort, but it may be for your best. The opportunity to go across the street and meet a neighbor, the opportunity to speak up when somebody else is putting somebody down. I pray that you will give us the wisdom and the courage to be available to what it is that you want to do in and through us. Father, thank you for the privilege of giving today, a testimony to our trust in your sufficiency in our lives, a testimony that we believe in the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. And so we thank you for the opportunity to do that today. We trust you for all this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. We also have a first-timer in church today. I don't normally point out first-timers in church because I don't like to embarrass folks, but I don't think she's going to remember it. And so Errol and Andy have a brand new baby girl with them today, all right? Maisie Joy, all right, is there, and she's covered up in that little pink blanket back over there. And I have a sneaking suspicion we're going to see a new Errol now that he has a girl instead of boys, all right? I think he's going to become quite soft now, all right? But anyway, congratulations, guys, all right? Yeah, I thought somebody might have to deliver that baby last Sunday, all right, when Andy was here at church. Andy, I looked for you Tuesday night. Because she told me, she said, Tim, if I have this baby today, I'm going to be there Tuesday night. So, but she had the baby Tuesday morning, very, very early, all right? So we gave her a pass, all right? So anyway, that is terrific. I invite you to take your Bibles and find Psalm 103, the same psalm we were in last week. We're going to be there again today. Oops, what just happened? There we go. Yesterday at Mark and Michelle's wedding, ran into a guy I hadn't seen in quite some time. And man, was I shocked. Last time I saw him several months ago, weighed about 230, 240. And when I saw him yesterday, I said, how much? He said, Tim, I weigh 170 now. My height, half an inch taller maybe. Okay, an inch taller. I said, wow, you look terrific. And when I got home, I got to thinking about how when we notice physical changes in people, we often comment. Lady gets her hair done, gets a new color on her hair, we comment, okay? Guy goes bald, okay? We comment. We have a tendency to notice those kind of physical characteristics. I wonder how often we notice spiritual development, spiritual maturity in each other's lives. Wonder how often we recognize it in our own. And then number two, when we do notice it in somebody else's life, how often do we comment about it? Hey, man, I've really seen some changes. Incredible. Awesome. I'm not sure that we do. My friend yesterday also reminded me of the title of this year's sermon series, The Less, More Lifestyle. There was a lot less of him than last time I saw him. And as we look at this from a spiritual side, we're looking at what are the things about self that we need less of so that Christ can reign more in our lives. More of Christ, less of me. We ask you at the beginning of the year, and if you're new to New Hope, I'll ask you to do this today or over the next few days. Spend some time praying. Say, God, what is there in my life that I need less of? Okay. Do I worry too much? Am I anxious too often? Am I too controlling? What is there in my life that I need less of so that there can be more faith, more trust, more dependence, more obedience? And let God, by the person of His Holy Spirit, direct you to what are the things in your life that are there needs to be some changes in. And then write that down on a piece of paper. Tuck it away in your Bible. And when we get to December, we're going to pull those out on a particular Sunday, and we're going to look back and say, okay, this is part of our accountability. Because in order for this less more lifestyle to be developed, in order for this guy to have gone from 240, 250 to 170, it started with a what? Started with a choice. He had to make a decision that he needed to change in his life. Same thing is true spiritually. We have to make the decision that we want to change in our life, but that's not a once and done decision. Mark and Michelle had a wedding yesterday. Today they have a marriage. The choice he made at the wedding, that will have to be made by Mark and Michelle every single day. Okay? It's not a once and done thing. Our walk with Christ, it's a daily choice. That means the choice must be consistent. Okay? In order to maintain consistency, we usually need accountability. Accountability with God, accountability with each other, and what enables all of this to take place is when you and I do what with the Word of God? Contemplate. And that's the reason that we are in the book of Psalms, is Psalms lend themselves to slow, steady thinking about what God is saying. So last week we introduced Psalm 103. We kind of want to wrap that up today. I'm going to read selected verses. I'm not going to read the whole thing in its entirety. I'm going to pull out verses as we try to wrap things up today. Last week I shared that there are five key directives or five key thoughts that we can find and look at in this particular song. First of all, David is the king of Israel when he writes this. And David tells us that first of all, opening words, praise the Lord, O my soul, and all my inmost being, praise His holy name. Soul music is the very soul of music. And David says, with everything that is within me, with my mind, my emotion, and my will, my innermost being, I am going to praise the Lord. You see, we should commence worship by blessing the Father. That should be the way we always start our worship, whether it's personal or public, is by bringing blessing to the Father. I don't know if you've ever in your life struggled with this idea of how can I bless God. I got to be honest, I have. That's a struggle. I mean, God is sufficient. God does not need me. God does not need you. He wants us, but He doesn't need us. What can I, as a finite, sinful, flesh-driven person, what can I do that will add anything to God? Because that's what we normally think of when we think of blessing. Somebody is adding something to me. I'm going to bless you with a new car. I'll take that one any day of the week, okay? I'm going to bless you with, and it's usually adding something. What do any of us have to bless God with? Nothing. Nothing. He doesn't need anything to be sufficient. So, let God kind of do some work in my head and say, okay, because the Bible tells us to bless the Lord. Oh, my soul. How does that happen? Dawned on me that one of the illustrations in the Bible that's used several times is God as Father. And we're His children. And so I got about thinking about my own kids. Hey, how do our kids bless us? Usually it's not because they add something to us. Okay? Ashley has promised when Shelly and I are older, she'll take care of us. Okay? But for many, many years, kids don't add in terms of stuff to their parents. But yet, our kids still bless me. They bless us when they honor us. They bless us when they ask for help. They bless us when they actually take the advice that we give them. Okay? Now, just so you know, God does not give advice. And God does not give suggestions. God gives commands. Okay? But in the human analogy, I'm blessed when they say, "Would you pray with me about?" I'm blessed when they say, "You know, I think this is what God has said to me." So there are blessings that come, though it doesn't add sufficiency to my life, though it doesn't add, quote, maybe substance to my life. I didn't need it to survive. It still brings grace. And I think that is what this means when you and I, as the children of God, are going to bless God. It happens, and David illustrates this in the latter part of this chapter when he says, you know, remember and obey his precepts. Remember and obey his word. Those are the ways in which we bless him. And all personal praise should start with blessing the Father. Second of all, we need to cease from forgetting the Father's benefits. That's very personal as well. And we started looking at that. We'll finish that up today. Then we are to comprehend the limits of the Father's anger. That's in verses 6 through 12. There's a change here that David stops talking personally, and David now starts talking like a king of Israel. And he's talking about the nation. And David is saying, hey, as a nation, we better not forget, okay, that there are limits to God's anger. God puts limits on that. And aren't we glad? He doesn't treat us as our sin indicates it should. Okay? He doesn't give us our just desserts. And aren't we glad for that? And David even makes reference here to Moses and the time of Israel. Let me just plant that in your head as a background. Do you remember when Moses led Israel out of Egypt and their first stop is at the mountain? And Moses goes up to have a conference with God, and God is taking his finger and he is chiseling into rock tablets the Ten Commandments. And Moses is going to carry those tablets back down and say, okay, here's the way we're going to live as a community of God's people in the world. And while Moses is up having a mountaintop experience with God, do you remember what the children of Israel are doing? Yeah, Moses has been gone for a day or two. Well, where's our leader? Well, let's figure out our own leader. So they threw all the jewelry into a pot, melted it, hand-shaped a golden calf, set it up on an altar. And when Moses comes down from the mountain, he sees all the people bowing down to this golden calf. And do you know what one of the first commands was? Thou shalt have no other gods before me. And Moses was angry. He was ticked. And he threw those tablets down and they cracked and they broke. And man, I think Moses wanted God to wipe them off the face of the earth. Why mess with these people? God put a limit on his anger. He didn't wipe them out. He said, Moses, come back up. Come back up. We'll do this again. Gave him a second chance. And a third and a fourth as we study the history. And God does the same thing for us. As a nation, we need to remember there are limits of the Father's anger. Number four, we need to consider the Father's compassion. As a nation, we remember how much God loves us and what he's done for us. And then it wraps up with continue in worship by obeying the Father's word. And last week, we got to cease from forgetting the Father's benefits, and we looked at, that's verses, beginning at verse 3. Don't forget all of his benefits. That's the end of verse 2. He forgives all of my sins. He heals all of my diseases. He redeems my life from the pit. He crowns me with love and compassion or mercy. And number 5, he satisfies my desires with good things so that my youth is renewed like eagles. And last week, we looked at the first thought in that area, and that is the first benefit that we should never forget is that God forgives all our iniquities. David shouts out in this passage, I am forgiven. He realizes that he is in a relationship with God because God loved him. Do you understand? Do you fully understand? Have you let it sink in that the reason Jesus died on a cross? Do you understand why Jesus allowed himself to be stripped naked, to be beaten with a cat of nine tails, to have a crown of thorns pressed into his scalp so hard that it made his head bleed? Do you understand why Jesus allowed himself to be nailed to a cross through his hands and through his feet? Do you understand Jesus allowed a Roman centurion to take a spear and to thrust it into his side as he hung there? Do you understand why? There was only one reason. Only one reason Jesus did that. It's because of your sin and mine. That is the basis of our forgiveness. No other reason. When you understand what it cost God the Father and what it cost God the Son, don't you think we ought not to forget that? We ought never to come to a place that we become calloused over by what Jesus Christ did for us. The second benefit, it says he heals our diseases. At first notice, you might say, whoa, Tim, what are you talking about? Prayer request time, you already talked about people with cancer, and you talked about people who have had strokes and who are sick. What do you mean he heals all of our diseases? It's pretty important to figure out what sometimes the Bible means by the words that are there. This word disease is the same word that's used in the book of Deuteronomy when God talks about the national diseases that he's going to send upon the children of Israel because they had broken covenant with God. God says there's going to be national consequence when you break your covenant with me. Deuteronomy 28:58 says, if you are not careful to do the words of the law, you may fear this glorious and awesome name, the Lord your God. The Lord will bring on you and your offspring extraordinarily afflictions, severe and lasting, sicknesses grieving and lasting, and I will bring upon you again the diseases of Egypt of which you were afraid. They will cling to you. Every sickness and every affliction that is not recorded in the book of this law, the Lord will bring upon you until you are destroyed. You see, there are consequences sometimes for our disobedience and rebellion, and it can be found in sickness and disease, used as a means of discipline, not only for a nation, but also for an individual. Do you remember when David committed his adulterous act with Bathsheba? Psalm 38 is David's repentance over that. And in the Psalm 38, David talks about how after he had committed that sin and he had refused to repent of it, the scripture says, David wrote, there is no soundness in my flesh because of God's anger. There is no health in my bones because of my sin. David later repented and he was healed. And in that case, we know that disease was a discipline for breaking the covenant. I also believe this healing of diseases is partially fulfilled at the finished work of Jesus Christ when the scripture says, by your stripes we are healed. And it's not dealing with the physical ailments of the body, it's dealing with the spiritual corruption of our soul. We know that as long as we live in this world, there is sickness and disease. Sometimes it's a punishment or discipline for our sin. Other time it's no fault of our own. Go read the book of Job. He did nothing to be sick. And then primarily diseases in this world are part of the fallen world ever since Adam sinned. It's the reason that death occurred in the first place. You go back and you study the first part of the Old Testament, people lived hundreds of years. And then after the flood, it began to be 70, 70 was the average. And now with modern medicine, we extend it a bit. But disease is still going to get us. We won't get out of this world unless Jesus comes again any other way. Bo is visiting his great-great-grandmother in New Mexico today. On his mother's side, she is 105 this weekend. She still runs an antique store. When she does go in, her favorite line is this: I'm the oldest antique in the store. But I got news for you, even though she's lived to be 105, sickness and disease is eventually going to take her life. You see, the scripture says the day will come when we go to heaven or when Christ comes to take us home, that then we will be in a place where there is no more sickness and no more disease and no more sorrow and no more pain. It is there that you and I will not live 100 years, and we will not live 1,000 years, and we will not live 1,000,000 years, and we will not live 1,000,000,000,000 years. We will live forever. Have you let that sink in at all? I mean, we think about 70, 80, 90 years. Wow, I hope I make it, you know, to 80. Hey, no, guys, eternity. Eternity, that's a long time. That's why the choice to trust in Jesus Christ is so very important, because that same amount of eternity that we would like to spend in heaven could be spent in hell. Do you understand that consequence? It's one or the other. There's no holding tank in between. And it's the choices we make today that determine that. God is our healer. The third benefit found in verse 4, he redeems our life from the pit. Have any of you ever lived in the pits? Hey, you ever say life's the pits? Didn't Irma Bombeck write a book on that subject? You know, life's a bowl of cherries and everything else is the pits or something like that. Yeah. In Okie language, that's down in the dumps. Have you ever lived there in the dumps and the pits? David obviously had. He said, he redeems my life from the pit. It's like the story I told last Sunday out of Phil Yancey's book about the young woman who left home as a teenager, and she ended up being a hooker for a pimp, and he abused her and he beat her, and she ended up waking up on a grate in a street one night for warmth and said, "Why, I could go home. Our family pet is better taken care of than I am." She certainly was living life in the pit. The prodigal son, the story that Jesus told in the New Testament, he was certainly a young man when he woke up in a pig's trough. He was in the pits. Might have called it a hog lot. Well, you got Joseph out of the Old Testament, whose brothers threw him in a pit, and we're going to leave him there for dead, and then at the last minute decided to sell him and make a little money off of him, and he ended up at a place called Potiphar's house, and Mrs. Potiphar tried to seduce him, and she lied about it, and he was thrown into another pit. It's called jail. That's pit living. But folks, going to hell is the worst pit living I can imagine. I wouldn't want it for anybody. The scripture says we were buried with him by baptism into death in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead, we too might walk in the newness of life. It is through Jesus Christ that he lifts us up out of the pit. There's an old story about a man in China who was walking on a rain slick road. He lost his footing and he fell into a ditch that was filled with mud. As he tried to move, it seemed to suck him just deeper and deeper every time. And the more he struggled, the bigger hold it had on him. As he was sinking in the mud, Buddha came by. And Buddha looked at him and said, "My, what a predicament you are in. Here in the paper that I will give you, it will tell you 10 ways to get out of the ditch." The man started reading and he tried the 10 ways of Buddha to get out of the ditch, only to discover the harder he tried, the deeper he sank. Then Confucius came along and looked at him and said, "You are in a terrible condition, my son. But I have good news for you. If you will walk 5 steps towards me, I will walk 5 steps towards you, and then together we can leave the ditch." But the man said, "Confucius, I can't even take 1 step. The more I struggle, the deeper I sink." Then Jesus came by, and Jesus looked at him. And Jesus took the crown off of his head, and he took the royal robe off of his back, and he slipped the sandals off of his feet, and he climbed into the pit. And he got beneath me, and he pushed me up until my feet could set on solid ground. Some of you in this sanctuary old enough to remember an old hymn we sang in the church. The words go like this: "From sinking sand, he lifted me with tender hands. He lifted me from shades of night to plains of light. Oh, praise his name. He lifted me." This is what love means. It means that Jesus Christ lifted us out of the pit and the muck and the mire of our sin, and he's put our feet on a solid rock. The fourth benefit that we should never, ever remember is he crowns us with steadfast love and mercy, with loving kindness and compassion. Love is best described in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. It's known as the love chapter, where it gives us definitions of love. It's patient, it's kind, it does not envy, it is not arrogant, it never quits or dies. And then mercy is not just a mere emotion, but it's an actionable compassion that takes into account the weaker condition of others, and it treats that condition with tenderness. This word is relational. If I say the word mercy, is there a name in history that just jumps out at you? Two out of three services have gotten it right. You could make it three out of three. Is there somebody, for me, this is just a name. As soon as I think of mercy, who had the gift of mercy and demonstrated it, anybody jump out at you? Bingo. All right, three for three. Mother Teresa. You see, Mother Teresa just did not see the poverty. Mother Teresa just did not see the suffering, and she just didn't send money that direction. Mother Teresa went, and she lived there. She got with them, and she lifted them up. Mercy is not mercy if there is not action. It's only pity. And it's not an act of the Spirit just to have pity for somebody. Mercy does something about it. Often it is our sin that keeps us from showing mercy and loving kindness to others. We wallow in the muck of our past sin. Even though the Scripture says there's no condemnation to those who are now in Christ Jesus, your feet are on solid ground, we often still live in the muck. Johnny Erickson Tada. How many of you recognize that name? Okay, about as many as who knew the name of Francis Chan last week. All right, I was so shocked how few people knew who Francis Chan was. Johnny Erickson Tada, she's in her early 60s. Johnny Erickson Tada wrote a book back when I was at the Bible House called 18 and No Time to Waste. She was about 21 when she wrote the book, but she talks about what happened when she was 18. She was a very athletic young lady. She dove into a lake and she hit her head on a rock and she instantly became a quadriplegic. No motion from the neck down. Her last name is now Tada. Actually, over 26, 27 years ago, she got married. Just put your head around that. Okay? A man knowing for the rest of his married life everything that needs to be done for his wife, he's got to do it. That's love. That's love. Johnny Erickson Tada knew God still had plans and purposes for her life, and she did not allow her quadriplegic condition to destroy her. The Bible House, we began to sell her greeting cards and her artwork. She had the most beautiful calligraphy I had ever seen. Did I tell you she was a quadriplegic? She put a brush between her teeth. Beautiful, exquisite. Go Google it when you go home today. John Erickson Tada, see her artwork, look at the card she's done. Here's what Johnny Erickson Tada wrote about this issue of sin and its frustration of trying to keep us in the muck. She said, why do we feel so bad about our past sins for so long once we're saved? She said, because we confuse sin with its impression. She said, if you have a notebook, let me show you how you can illustrate this. She said, write the word sin on the top page of the notebook and press hard. Now tear off that top piece of paper, crumple it up, throw it across the room into the garbage can, let it be hauled away. That's how God forgets our sin as far as the east is from the west. Now take up your pencil, kind of lay it flat on the piece of paper that's now on top, rub it at an angle across the paper, back and forth in the same location where you'd written the word sin on the page above it. Now what shows up? The impression of the word sin. And guess what? That's what our flawed memories do for us. Do you and I go back over the deep impressions left by the transgressions that we committed or were committed against us? And when we do, we feel just as guilty as we did. It's as if the sin never left us. But you and I need to be encouraged. We need to remember the impression of sin is not the same thing as sin. And will you and I continue to work over forgiven sin as with a pencil, or will we let the Holy Spirit work His loving kindness and mercy in us and move those sins and their impressions as far as the east is from the west? You and I should never forget that God forgets our sin. Our last benefit verse 5, who satisfies us with good. I find it interesting that the last benefit in this remarkable chain is satisfaction. I grew up when a band made popular a song called Satisfaction. Some of you remember it? Over the lines, I can't get, he didn't pass English class, all right? I can't get no satisfaction. David says, you can find satisfaction when you remember not to forget. When you remember these things, you will be satisfied. Satisfies my desires with good things. You and I can be so easily entertained by things of this world, toys made by man's hands and minds that can distract us from real satisfaction. Do you know what the most current distraction is right now? Pokemon. Yeah, Pokemon. People get it into car wrecks because they're playing Pokemon while they're driving. People walking out and getting hit by a car playing Pokemon because they're going to find him. And my question is, are people looking as much for Jesus as they are Pokemon? Because I suspect you might find Pokemon in hell someday. Okay? It's just a thought. He doesn't mind taking them into the middle of the street. Who knows where he'll take you? I'm just poking fun at Pokemon, actually, but the point is, where are we finding our contentment and our satisfaction? David says, if we find it in remembering what God has done for us, then God does something incredible for us. It says, we will be renewed, our youth will be renewed like an eagle's. Let me clear up, first of all, what it's not saying. It's not saying if you're old, you're going to be young again. In this life. But it's saying, though your body may be aging, your spirit is still renewed, like that of a young person. It's what Paul wrote when he said in the New Testament, outwardly we are wasting away, but inwardly we are being renewed day by day. Here's the deal, folks. You cannot use old age as an excuse for getting crotchety. Okay? Because you can be renewed by God's Holy Spirit, who does not know a limit of age, no matter how old you are. Caleb and Joshua at 80 years of age were still as strong to go into the land as promised at 80 as they were at 40. That was by the renewable work of the Holy Spirit upon their life. And that can happen to us. It's not because of the large size of an eagle's wings that they can soar. Baby eagles who can fly can soar. Because what is it that makes an eagle soar? Again, somebody else in my generation wrote a song. Wind beneath my wings. You see, when they soar, they're not working at all. They're coasting. They're functioning under a power greater than themselves. And David says, when you and I will remember not to forget, and we will trust in God, and we will obey His word, we will now soar like eagles. The Holy Spirit providing for you and me what we could never, ever do for ourselves. Let me wrap this up. This passage tells us that we should comprehend the limits of the Father's anger. You see, God has the right to allow us to go to hell. He never sends one person to hell. God never sends anybody to hell. We go there of our own free will. But the desire of God is not to send anybody there. He's put limits on His anger, demonstrated at the cross of Jesus Christ. He is righteous and He is just, but He's put limits on His anger in the person of His Son. We must consider the Father's compassion, verses 13 through 18. As a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear Him. This idea of fear has two aspects to it. Number one, and I think we've gotten away from this in 21st century spiritual thinking. There's a side that you and I ought to be terrified of God. There is a side of, hey, have you ever shook hands with a guy 7 foot tall? Okay, I have on one occasion. And he seemed to be a very nice person. but I didn't want to make him mad. I shook hands with Wilbur Plogger one day at the Bible House. I literally asked Wilbur, could I have my hand back? It was gone. His hands were so big, so powerful, he could have crushed me right then. And yet Wilbur Plogger, one of the kindest, gentlest men I've ever met. But yet there was a force and a power there. And you and I need to understand, we're finite, he's infinite. And there ought to be a sense, why would I ever want God to get mad at me? The other part of fear is this idea of respect. Of respect and honor. You see, God is as approachable as a loving father, and he is as awesome and fearful as a tornado and an earthquake rolled into one. And those truths ought to remind us to worship him in great humility. I remember a Sunday morning at Ashbrook Church, the church that Dad had started. I was in my late 20s. I'd started doing the regular Sunday morning preaching by then. And the church was only about 115, 120 at the time. And visitors were obvious. Okay, in church. Visitors were obvious. And that particular Sunday, we had three generations of women show up. There was a grandmother and a mother and a daughter. The daughter was about 18 or 19, I think. And mom was probably late 30s, early 40s. And grandma was, you know, a young person about my age, probably in her 60s. And they were very nice, very pleasant, greeted them. We had the service. In the middle of that sermon, that's when that earthquake hit. Remember the big earthquake in Central Valley back in the 80s, okay? And that big earthquake. And we had lights in Ashbrook Sanctuary, kind of they hang down, but then they were big round balls. Big round balls. Those things in that earthquake, they just start swinging. Like this. And you kind of stop in the sermon, and our eyes got about this big. And it lasted for about 10 or 12 seconds, and you know, start preaching again, a little aftershock hit, you kind of pause, you pray, finish the sermon. That day I felt compelled to have an altar call and invite people forward that service. And at that service, I couldn't get the altar call out of my mouth fast enough. If you'd like to come and receive Christ your Savior, while we listened to the song, Just As I Am, and those three ladies, boom, boom, right there. And I greeted them at the altar, and I said, you know, thank you so much for being in church today. What brought you forward today? And it was the mother of the three who said, hey, my mom and I just said we hadn't been in church in 20 years, and if God's going to shake the earth the first time we come back, we better get right. I thought, gee, that was good thinking, all right? And there's a sense there was some awe and fear of God at that moment. And there is a healthy sense of understanding that. And so we need to remember that. So remember the Father's compassion, comprehend his limits on his anger, cease from forgetting the Father's benefits, commence worship by blessing the Father, and wrap it up with this, continue in worship. Continue in worship daily by obeying the Father's word. If all your worship is the raising of your hands and the lifting of your voice with a song, and that's where it stops, it's fake worship. It's fake. It's not the real deal. Real worship ends up with obedience to God's direction in my life. If you're single, who's God bringing your life to marry? If you're single, should you get married? If you're married, how you treat your spouse? If you're a parent, how you raise your children? If you're an employer, the ethics you use to carry out your work. If you're an employee, the way in which you work. Everything in our life, from our pleasure to our problems to our profession, should be in obedience to God himself. John Newton is the guy who wrote the book, the song, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. John Newton was a slave trader. He was a vile, despicable, ugly man, and he found Christ, and he wrote the song that saved a wretch like him. What most folks don't know is the end of that story. John Newton died at age 82. In the last sermon that he preached, he said, "My memory is nearly gone, but the two things I remember, one, what a horrible sinner I was. And number two, what a great Savior Jesus is. May you and I worship with our very last breath through this life of what a great Savior Jesus is. Let's pray. Our Father, I thank you for the life that you share with us. Father, your word is incredibly deep. This psalm, it's one that's easy to skip right by and to miss so much. And God, I touched the tip of the iceberg. This is one of those songs that you had David write that is so deep, it is so rich, it is so full. There is so much for us to contemplate each phrase so it makes a difference in the way in which we live. God, we need wisdom on how to live life in this century. There have been other centuries of believers in history past that have had struggles and challenges and national problems and world challenges. And here we are again in this century, Father, wondering how to live life. I pray that we'll make the commitment here to live life by not forgetting the benefits you've provided. And out of those benefits, God, we will discover your strength, your courage, your passion for every single life on the face of this earth. From the Ivory Coast of Africa to the shores of the Pacific Ocean in California, from the North Pole to the South Pole, from those, Father, who go and serve this country in the military and in law enforcement, to those, Father, who clerk in stores and serve in hospitals, no matter the color or the complexion of our skin, no matter in which the culture that we came out of, whether we've been law-abiding or, Father, whether we've spent time incarcerated, may we understand that you love every single one of us and you want to make a difference in every single one of our lives. And God, I hope we'll let you. It will not just make our plans for having a great career and a wonderful retirement, but God, we will make plans that only follow your purposes in life. Teach us how to do that. In Jesus' name, amen. Guys, have a great afternoon.